Dr. Online, Joint Director of Chorus Global Consulting. He has received the top 50 Smart Healthcare Leader Award in November 2018. He is a visionary leader, technocrat with Masters in Computer Science, Bioinformatics and Management. He has over 2 decades of experience working in healthcare, pharma technology, healthcare, pharma process standardization, health leadership roles in US, Canada, and Asia. Much experience. Now he is a consultant at board level of healthcare funds and large healthcare organizations. He has many milestones and not only. But he has some rare distinctions. Top 50 healthcare leaders award, ACRE 500, Pharma Digital Transformation Award, Healthcare IT Block, 75,000 hits, 11,000 clinical corrections, and top 10 hits on Google with keywords HCG, Sandler, and Pedro Saiz. So he has actually vast experience, so I am sure you will learn from his expertise and experience. A hearty welcome to you, sir, at Global.
Thank you. build a new brand and then talk about the scope for you guys in terms of what are the goals of the market. So I started as a dentist.
As you
manufacture a lot in automotive, aerospace, this, that, manufacturing, but not so much in the textile. So she didn't have much. And so I started reading. So I found that Papa's idea of business. So Papa's manufacturing business had a lot of ideas. But the rest of them can be done. I started reading more. I said, you know, why does that happen? So I reached out to a lot of people. And I asked them that why IT does not come to them. So the answer I got was that healthcare is generally a laggard in adopting anything new. So healthcare lags behind. And so is the case with IT. And healthcare hasn't sort of, you know, adopted IT. That gave me curiosity started rising. I said, can I do something? If IT has made a change everywhere, can I do something in healthcare? So that is when I started looking out and said, I should talk to my other friends who are in healthcare. I reached out to them and said, what's going on? Maybe there's an opportunity. That opportunity didn't happen. There was an organization in California. They were doing a product development for healthcare. They had already done a lot of automotive business in practice. And now they want to use their product. So they said, I was practicing in Delhi. And they said, you know, we have a development center in Pune. They are a California resource. We have to have a good thing to do this work. And I started to bring up my practice. They said, you know, so this white business company convinced me that come in and spend time with us for, say, you know, 4 months. And then, you know, decided to come out. Okay. So I went there for 4 months, built a new product for them. And that was a learning point. I never looked back. So it was almost like 4 months I never came. That product sold like hotcakes in the US market. And then the company said, you know, you want to go to the US market. And in those days, medical getting a US visa was almost impossible. So this company had to do all kinds of surgery to get me a US visa. And then I went to the US and I, the visa was like that, I had to go back and forth. So I could not stay there for long. I would go and implement on that, go and implement on that. And I did a whole lot of implementations. So it was like almost very well to have. So, you know, I was, you know, a few sets of clothes in the bag and always on the plane. I lived a life of that sort for a couple of years. And then, you know, 2001 happened. I don't know how many of you know about 2001. In 2001, two things happened. One was 9/11. All of you may be aware about 9/11. And the second thing was dot-com bust. So there was something called dot-com bust. So dot-com bust, in those days, a lot of companies, they just produced their websites and they called them .com. You would even say, you know, you would even see popular.com, manpower.com, and they would list it on the stock exchange and their stock price for this union. It was running inside, you know, it was just a website and their valuation was shooting up. What happened is that last month, the industry figured out that this is a super number. So they had dot-com crash. And people who didn't know about what actually why I am telling you this story because of you. Because it was due to the game, it was due to the IT game, so to say. And I could not figure out that healthcare IT is different. I said, if my IT is crashing, what now is, you know, companies are shutting down their friends. All my friends were getting PinkSlips. PinkSlip is, you know, basically it's a term that you have to let go of somebody, you have to fire somebody, you just put up a PinkSlip on the table and the person considers that he's fired. So, everybody is getting PinkSlips. I was not getting PinkSlips. So I went to the CEO of the organization and asked him, where is my number? He laughed. He said, no, you're okay. Your division is doing okay. So what does that mean? So he said, you know, healthcare is not a problem. Everything else we get into a crash, but the healthcare division, the company sold up the healthcare division to Accenture to survive. And this company actually survived because they sold up their healthcare division. Otherwise, they would have shut shop. So I learned a very important lesson. Healthcare IT, although doesn't have a huge, you know, upscale, but it also doesn't have a downscale. So it always goes stable like this. So, you know, if you go, you understand what I'm trying to say, right? So spikes and troughs will not happen in healthcare. That was a valuable lesson. I said, you know, this is the place to be. I may not make the top dollar when the upswing is happening. But at the same time, the job is secure. I'm not going to lose it when the downturn is happening. So healthcare IT will always go at a slow, steady pace. I said, okay, I'm in the right place. So many of my IT colleagues quit their jobs and get the other things. So I went and joined an organization for some time. I came back from the 9-year-old grandmother. So a lot of problems with technology was decided to come back to it. And I joined an organization for some time. And I got into the licenses. So during this process, I also worked on doing a genome project. So human genome project is this. How many of you had heard of the human genome project? Many have. So, human genome project wrote the genetic blueprint. So, the entire genome was that. All the bioinformatics, genomic sciences, proteomic sciences, they all came out of that. So, I had written a software at that point in time for a company called iBiosystems. This was a system known as Celera, Celera Advanced Genome Project. And this software, I wrote it. This became a patent. The organization patented it because have you heard about PCR or these tests which are there? Yeah. So this PCR machines used globally. In those it was manufactured by just a handful of doctors. Now they're working for months. And the software that runs it at one point was created by me. So now of course there are many other blueprints. This used to be called as a microarray, microarray plates. So these microarray plates, which DNA molecule goes into which well of the plate. So there are already as well as the life sciences side, pharma side, biotech side, there is a lot of work there. So that's one example of very interesting work that happened. And I'm talking with, but then he goes with in India and goes in there. I was fortunate I got the opportunity to work for 2 years. Then I came back to India. I joined this organization called Sachin Network. This is a regular IT services company servicing the US market. Whatever it was, they asked me to set up a biomedical company. So I set up a biomedical company. Now, when I set this up, it was a joint team of biotech scientists, medical doctors, and some technology people, which is computer science. So they gave me the best of the best of the best. Right up to the scientific organization in Hyderabad, this was, I don't know if you have heard of the CCMD, the Center for Cellular Biology and Molecular Biology. So it was going there. My task was to build this cross-functional team. Now this cross-functional team was difficult to build because you know the way the training is done, the education is done. So all the medical education and scientific education as well as biology research is concerned, a lot of work learning. So let me ask you, how many of you have built the laboratory? Some sort of medical. How many of you have found biological research, biotech laboratory? Few of you. How many of you are from computer science background? How many of you are from other background, including management science background? A good list. Okay. So, if you are going through medical education, it's a lot of work. You know what is work like, right? Retina. Technical education of any sort, which is computer science or any engineering discipline. Education is by grids and numbers. So it's all like, you know, grids and numbers. So you have to understand it and not really memorize it. It's not so much a road. So the way that education is done is different. So the brain works differently. So my task was to create a team, which is a cross-functional team of people who think very differently. Now, I'll give you an example. And this is something that I realized when I was trying to do a cross-functional. Of course, after that, I've done many cross-functional teams in my life. But I'm giving you this one specific example. So, when I was in my medical office, I do surgery, you will show me, okay, this is bright red, this is pink, this is bluish, this is pale yellow. For me, in my first year, everything was pink. I could not differentiate. Everything was pink. Either it was red or pink. So, you know, mostly red. Because we're doing surgery and everything is red. But this guy is saying, look at this tissue, it is pale. It is bluish. Where is bluish? What happened? is exactly the core of the challenge. Because as 12, we are okay. Why did you have LSP that day? We didn't have LSP that day. And Mr. Bhatte never ever meet. Never. And we are trying to create a team which is a short functional like this. So we were hard, very hard. But help me all.
Yeah.
and don't come back to us asking for their salaries. You have to figure out where to pay their salaries. Back home in all this. Actually, I have never done this. Back home, this guy. So I went and recruited, again, a cross-functional team from management, back at the board game, from HR, from management, from IT, from healthcare, all kinds of people. I had a whole lot of doctors in IT at that point. A lot of hardcore computer science engineers from IITs. And I had management people from IIS and all that. So I had a very diverse group. And I had to stitch them together again, just like on the right side of it. And again, I had to stitch them together. So what did I do? I made it a similar program. So, learn what I tell you. So this was the program they all sat in my office, my staff, partner, and at the end of 6 months, I said, whoever passes, will get your certification and you get a job. If you don't pass, it still will be your certification, but you don't get a job. So this was a successful one that won't give you a regular posting. So I still runs it. So, you know, what I'm trying to say is that you need these possible knowledge to be able to do it. So that's the space that I'm on. So I do it now. Now let me jump a little bit forward. What's coming? Now what's coming is on the digital side. What was part of healthcare IT is transforming into digital health. There is a difference. You've got the technology shift that's happening, the business shift that's happening. In the digital, we call these like SMAs. I sort of have an acronym for it. We call it SMAC-IoT. What it means is social media, mobile, analytics, AI, cloud, and IoT. These are some of the changes we have. Of course, there are still more things that have got added. Blockchain has got added to it. And now, you know, CRM has got added. But anyway, so this is an acronym. I'm talking a little bit about it. All of you are familiar with social media, I'm sure. It has become a part of it. Right? So what made it happen? What made it happen? Anyhow. Why what made social media such a huge success?
Making
news. No, but what made it happen? This device. This is what made it happen. Before the mobile came, it was on the PCs, so you would have to sit at one place in the PC and then you have to go on it. Or the laptop, right? Now, then, you know, the computing power that was there in PCs and computers is more than that is available on their phones now. So the computing power went up. I remember when I told you this story about where I started. When I learned programming, I was learning programming Java. seen or heard about the Apple Watch?
Not a good man,
okay.
That's a lot of very good.
So Apple Watch is a game changer. Apple as a company is not a medical device company. But they have used a medical device in their watch. And then they put it to FDA and say approve it. FDA said, first of all, it's not a medical device. Very tight company. Second, we usually take about 2 to 3 years to give approvals for only then I will certify you as a medical device. Then, you know, Apple is Apple, they say, this is a different class. And people are ready to start using it. So, what do you say? The FDA actually utilizes, you know, speedy approval. So, they get a new class on which they get approved. Okay? So, what I'm trying to say is, now we are moving to mobile first. Earlier, the software that were built were built for enterprise class. And enterprise class is all gone. It is mobile first. So, any software that you build now is mobile first. So, all healthcare software that you look at are all coming as mobile first. So, digital bolt on earlier, you know, client server, large enterprise, you would have bolt on top of it. That's all gone. That's no longer there. Now what you have is mobile, that is social media. Social media, mobile are everything on the phone. It's all mobile apps, mobile first. And then, analytics. Earlier, if you went to do analytics, it would take a long time for you to come up with the hypothesis, then you would come up with the data, then you would come up and say, okay, this is the way I have to do the analysis of the data. Some of the analysis will work, some of it will not work. Then try to figure out if you are a Java. If you are a Java, start it. Okay. All the effort is lost. Now what happens? The technology given you, it has given you a very flexible way of playing around with data. Even if you don't have clean data, still you can play around with it. And you can play around with it on the fly. Okay. So you can actually do what you were able to do in, say, 2 years, people would do PhD on analytics. And they would use some amount of data analytics. Now, looking back, people were having analytic PhDs, say, 10 years earlier. Now, when you look at that, it would be interesting. Because you no longer need that at a time, I can produce that in a week. Not by week, 2 days. So the machine is going to do it for me, I'm not going to do that. So it has completely taken on a new term. Analytics now is on the fly, it is on the point of use. It has gone to a point where you define what you want to see, the machine will give it to you. Haven't you gone to Google and said, okay, Google, tell me this? You give an answer, you need it. How does it do it? All analytics. All artificial intelligence and that. All of that is being used for healthcare, extensively being used for healthcare. Now you are getting models which are on the fly. Research organizations are finding it tough to deal with such rapid change in technology. Healthcare is finding it very, very difficult to deal with it. Earlier, clinical guidelines, people who are from healthcare background, clinical guidelines would go through a medical board. They would spend long time to figure out whether you want this clinical guideline is right or not. That process is still there. But then what is beginning to happen is analytic engines and AI engines are able to give you the answer. So the evidence-based medicine has assumed a completely new meaning. So evidence-based medicine earlier was that you have to find all these products which are now coming are changing the pattern so rapidly that our regulatory framework is not even better. And I'm dealing with my current role, I'm dealing with that on a daily basis. So, you know, I haven't talked about my current role at all because that's not the objective. But currently I'm dealing with the regulatory side. And I'm dealing with how make India jump or leapfrog from where it is to completely the new level. So I'm trying to leap forward. Now some of these things that I'm talking about, many of these things may look like, you know, and especially our previous generation continues to say the higher of the thing. India has lived in the 70 years of slow growth. No longer have a leadership in the government which wants to move capital forward. The current Prime Minister has said $5 billion economy. A $5 billion economy is not going to happen on sick people. 2 to 6% of India's population falls below the poverty line every year because of unaffordable healthcare expenses. That is why Ayushman Bharat was created. And you get part of my tomorrow. Now, these are the changes which are coming. We are talking about universal health coverage. If we talk about universal health coverage, health insurance becomes a driver. I have all, so first I talked about biotech, life sciences, and I gave you my experience on healthcare informatics. Now I'm shifting gears and going to health insurance. Health insurance globally is the driver for change. In India, health insurance does not get the value lower because if you look at numbers, because only 3% of India's population that is covered by health insurance. If you include the government health insurance program also, that is only 10%, that's 13%. Still, that is small. Now, what is really going to happen because of Ayushman Bharat is the Prime Minister has already announced that it is already being rolled out. 40% of India's population has found the coverage. Next year, it will go from 40 to 80%. That comes into the rate, it will happen. So, what does that mean? It creates a completely new paradigm. It creates a new paradigm because financial lever comes in. Health insurance, when it becomes a financial lever, it will come and start. So, they don't want to pay more, right? They're a business. So, they will pay only for. What do they pay for? Why will any health insurance pay for? And if government is health insurance, why will they pay for? Why will they do their health insurance? Why? I said it this time, I'm just asking you. If you receive it. What part? Now, I have a faculty. $5 billion economy, you need healthy people. Higher productivity, you need higher productivity, you need healthy population. You need a healthy population, you need to cover all their healthcare expenses. Right? That is the reason they would want to put the money there. And if they put that money, they don't want to create sickness. They don't want more sick people. They want to catch the illness earlier. As early as possible. And primary care level. And the onset of the disease, you want to catch that. That particular paradigm of disease management, which was not existing in this country so far. The paradigm should be completed. The standards have already been written for us. The standards have already been notified. It's only a matter of implementation now. For implementation, the funding is being brought on the table. Enough funding is being put on the table. From the private sector side, from the government side, and from the FDR. FDR is foreign direct investment. So, huge investment is going into the IT. Huge. Okay? It's a paradigm shift. It's a paradigm shift in industrialization. It's never happened in this country. For 70 years, they have never seen something like this. Okay, coming to the last point which I was supposed to talk. what kind of people are required. As the nice calculations which we've done internally for some of the people that shared with you. So if you calculate for bed to population ratio, then you also calculate the doctor to patient ratio, and you calculate the number of people required for each medical document be created, and the document is a technology document, it's a key document. Simple thing like a stat summary, electronic stat summary. You need at least one person, one full-time equivalent for doing one document, an average, it's a loaded kind of model. So you have calculation that you need 26 lakh people between me, healthcare provider, and health insurance in the next couple of years. There are the people, 26 lakh, that's the demand. All the institutes put together, we've done analysis, there are only 61 institutes in this country who are producing some sort of health informatics, some sort. Some are bioinformatics, some are health informatics, some are like biomedical engineering, some are medical software, there are some, all of them call it a different name, but there are only 61. These 61 are also not teaching everything. See, I told you, I gave an example of high-tech, healthcare IT, and health insurance. Health insurance is moving to a point where it will become like a credit card. Right? You swipe your card and it's done. Today, health insurance has to do what people have to do. They have to fill the form, this and that, wait for their adjudication to happen and all that. No. We are completely leapfrogging to something called auto adjudication of claims. Completely auto adjudication. Just like fintech. The same fintech model is coming to health insurance. Who's going to do it? You need people from financial background. You need people from management background. You need people from healthcare background. You need people from behavior. Everybody is required. But there is a capacity. There is no capacity. Right now there is none. All these 61 courses are put together. All of them are how much are they producing? Even if you know I say, each one has to be able to make a framework. Calculate yourself. You don't have to do that. 61 courses in India, 20 to 30 each. How many have you used in the year? How many do you need? 26 lakh. Where are they? I will stop. Any questions if you want to have? Happy to answer questions if you have
any questions? No questions, that seems to be a question.
How do you plan to this deficit just mentioned? What is the way ahead?
What is the way ahead?
All right.
for you guys to figure out with what you want to do in your life. If you decide you want to play this game,